introduce Professor Milind Sohoni, an alumnus of IIT Bombay. He did his BTech in computer science from IIT Bombay in 1986. Then went to the US, spent some time there, then came back to IIT Bombay and completed his PhD in 1994. In CS, his formal interests are in optimization.
Correct.
That's what I am told. However, his personal interests were in hiking, trekking, and his tours in the Western Ghat took him to various places, and he appreciated the ground situation there. And that brought him to a parallel channel work on rural areas. At IIT Bombay, we have a Center for Technology Alternatives for Rural Areas known as CITARA. And he started working with that. And today he is going to tell us something about one of his projects in the Karzat area of Maharashtra. Okay. You can look at his projects in various ways. Rural work, a CS professor doing something which obviously for many of you is not mainstream CS or may not be CS at all. But I think he will emphasize and we will appreciate the methodology of research and related themes in this work. Professor Sohoni.
So, well, thank you very much for this introduction. So, I am going to sit down and give a talk in the old tradition of pravachan or kirtan. So, I hope you will appreciate the new way of doing things too, or the old way of doing things. So let me begin. So I hope you're all at the presentation that I had said. So engineering and society, right? A teaching and research paradigm for national development. So so this is really to emphasize that engineering is actually a social skill, something like a potter or a carpenter. So they have to interpret society or what it needs, what the customer needs, and then design for it and then satisfy the customer. So I am going to point out what is the connection of engineering and its research and development and teaching with society. So there will be four main themes in the talk: the method of science and the method of engineering, what it means, what does science mean, and how does engineering extend the role of science. The second thing is about society and development. So it's, you can call it the customer side or the, because ultimately our output is to be consumed by society. Then I am going to connect this up and give you a case study which is on drinking water, and show how engineering and society relate to each other via drinking water as an example. Finally, I will just what are the outcomes of this talk and how to go ahead. So that was the last topic that I will do. So let's start with science. So of course science is about observing phenomena in the physical or social sciences and explaining them. So the first part of science is obviously observation and documentation. So I think a lot of talks in this series have been about observing stuff and various phenomena, noting them down, documenting it, using measurements and so on. So that is the first part of science, is observation and writing, documenting your data. The second part is about formulating a law which tries to explain how this particular phenomenon happens, right? So let's call it. So it's basically constructing a relationship between the variables that we are observing. And finally, when we make that law, we have to test it whether that law is correct or wrong, and if it fails, then we have to modify our law. And so on. So this above steps are repeated till the law actually satisfactorily explains what we went out to explain. So here is an example of the levels of water in a borewell, in a village called Ambiste. So I have observed this data over many years, say over 30 years, and I have plotted on April 5th on 2005. I observed 3.8 meters, so I make a plus. So each plus in that figure is actually an observation, right, over many years. So with that observation, this is my data. So as I said, the first step is about data and document observation and documentation. So I have documented it. The second step is also illustrated here. I want to make a model for the behavior of water in that observation well. So what did I do? I just drew a straight line, and the best fit straight line in that graph is the best fit straight line is my law. So you see that the law is not bad. It does pass through most of the data, and all other data I can probably explain that maybe there was an error in the observation, maybe that day was a bad day, or maybe there was some extraction from the well, and so on. So the law is satisfactory because it explains how water behaves in that bore well, right? Next, let's look at the next example. So here I've picked up an example from social sciences. So here we see that each plus is actually the data related to a village in a particular tehsil or taluka. So I've taken Shahpur taluka of Thane, and you know there are about 200 or 150 villages, and for each village I have plotted on the x axis the literate fraction, okay, and on the y axis I have plotted the population of the village who are under 6 years of age, so the children in the village. So if you pick a particular plus, say for example let's pick this plus, this one, right? So you see here for this plus the literate fraction is roughly 50%, and the fraction of people under the fraction of children is 13%, so 0.13 and 0.15. So each of these villages is one plus, and if you look at this plot you see something very interesting, that as the literacy improves, right, or increases, the fraction of children in the village decreases, right? So I will now to construct a law, I just take the simplest law, the best fit line, and I see that the line is sloping down, right? So that means that if I want to have a family planning objective, then perhaps a good way of doing it would be to increase the literacy. Is that correct? So you see that these are the two things which actually unite the physical science and the social science. The feeling that if you have this data, you can explain this data using laws. That is the basic method of science. So now let's look at engineering. So engineering really says that, you know, engineering first of all is where do I want to be. So science is fine, science describes reality, while engineering wants our reality to be different, right? So engineering by nature is about change. So for example, I would like, where do I want my borewell water to be? I would obviously like it as close to the ground as possible and not as deep. For example, where would I like my villages to be? I would, for example, I would like them to be literate, or I would like them to, to population to be controlled, and so on, right? Or for example, let's look at a more practical problem. So how should my city's public transport be, right? So these are all questions which are objectives, which are scientific objectives, which society values. So is that clear? So we have moved from science to engineering. In the sense that, so the method of engineering is now should be clear, that we have started with a societal problem, a problem which society has posed, and we have a stakeholder, somebody is posing it. For example, the city, corporation may ask that, how do I improve my public transport? Or your MLA or your local member of parliament or the minister will say, how do I keep my population down, right? So these are objectives which may be posed to you by, let's call them customers or stakeholders. The next objective, the next step in engineering is to analyze the problem and separate it into elementary problems. So for example, if you want to improve the public transport, then maybe your drivers should be trained better, maybe your conductors should be more civil, maybe the routes should be different, maybe the timings of the year should be more frequent, buses should be, so there are many aspects to it. There may be civil engineering aspects, mathematical aspects, sociological aspect, mere curtain, civic sense or whatever. So the next step is to divide the problem into several parts, right? So that there is this objective and there are many problems. So then the third step is to solve each of these problems, right, individual problems, and synthesize them into a complete solution, right? Once the solution is complete, you present it to the stakeholder and say, well, here, are you happy, are you satisfied? If not, then we have to, you know, redo the engineering cycle. Just as there was a scientific cycle where you had a theory and then you tested it and it was unsatisfactory, then you have to do the thing again. Even here in the engineering cycle, you have a stakeholder and you have a problem to solve. You try solving it, give it to the stakeholder, doesn't work, do it again, right? So you see that while science tries to describe, if you see reality, engineering is actually about change and delivering change, right? So it's not only about change, but it's also that it should be delivered to society. So what are the components of changing society or changing ourselves? So there are two parts to it. One I have called as modeling, and the second part is called design. Okay. So let me explain modeling and design in my next slide. Right. So here is my picture. All of you are college teachers, and all of you are teaching, you know, young budding engineers. So it is important to understand what are the basic engineering skills as we see it, or we should tell our students what is an engineer, what is the ideal role of an engineer, correct? So here is a schematic or a diagram of what I call the true engineer. So there are two parts to the true engineer. If you look at the top line, there is a modeling and then there is design, right? And the you see that the true engineer is actually interacting with society on the right, correct? So you see that as the what does the modeling part do? Well, modeling part interfaces with society. So it looks at what, you know, identifying the problem, you know, and finally deploying the problem. Yeah. Should I stop? No. So these are the right. And the second part is actually the design. So once I get a problem, like say for example, I get, you know, improve the public transport, correct? Then you have to analyze the problem. So that takes you to the And then you split up the problem into many parts, right? There may be civil engineering part, maybe some psychology, some sociology, IT, maths, whatever. Then you synthesize the solution and, you know, deploy it, right? So again, deployment is also a modeling because it is interfacing with society, correct? So a true engineer actually must do all of these things. Is that clear? Right? And you see that it needs three important skills. First of all are the societal skills, right, which you have to be able to deal with society, understand what is going on. Then the creative skills, and then finally the domain knowledge, right? That you are a mechanical engineer or you're a civil engineer, you have to use, you know, maybe you have to design a boiler, or, you know, in chemical you have to do a reactor or a program or whatever, right? So the domain knowledge is only the last part of the engineering cycle, right? So immediately you will see that the true engineer must actually be interdisciplinary. He or she must have an idea of how other areas or other fields also work. So he or she cannot just say that I am a mechanical engineer, I don't know what civil engineering does, right? If you want to build a water tank, you may have to know about what are the rules and regulations, who to talk to, how is the village arranged, where should I locate the tank, how do people go, where is the school, and so on, right? So a true engineer must be able to actually handle or cross disciplines, right? Must be able to do sociology, he may have a course training, but he must be able to, you know, jump across different disciplines, right? And remember that in this, the true engineering, the research actually happens at this part, right? Far, far away from society, correct? So if research has to benefit society, then we must need the skills of societal skills and creative skills, right? So if our research has to go from the domain side to society, then we need those middle layers, otherwise our research is not going to benefit society. So let us see, you know, there are several models of how a society, like, you know, for example, American society has different view of engineering, Indian society has a different view of engineering or different practice of engineering. Japanese engineering, you remember that, you know, we all said, wow, Japanese engineering is really great. So different countries, different cultures, different times have different views of society. So let us and engineering. So let us look at one particular example. How does a company run? Okay. So company, for example, is an important construction. So what does company do? Well, company is organized in departments. So there is a marketing department, there is a finance department, then there is manufacturing, then design, HR and so on, right. So how does the company interact with society? Well, the sales and the marketing department sees, spots an opportunity. For example, they will say that a rose or you know Head and Shoulders or dandruff preventing shampoo is now the need of the market, right. So then, so it spots a need, so maybe some soap tablet, a new rose colored soap is needed or whatever. And the sales and marketing then talks to the finance and says that, well, we perceive this way and these are the profits that you are going to make. And then maybe the finance talks to marketing, marketing will talk to the design and so on and so forth. And finally, the product will come back to the sales and marketing team department and the product is sold, right. And each of these departments have employees, which I have shown as little blue dots. You see, you, those, these are employees, correct. So all of these departments have small employees sitting inside them and the company is actually doing the whole thing, right. Is that clear? So obvious consequence of this is that the employee now need not be interdisciplinary at all. The employee can be unidirectional, you know, they can only know, they need not know so many things, they can only know one thing, correct. The next thing is that what are the problems which companies are going to take up? Obviously, which give them the maximum profit, right. So you see that the company is going to take up problems which give them the best, you know, remuneration, profits and so on. No problem with that, that is the way it should function, right. So as a result, what is going to happen, what is happening is that our companies are focusing on IT, pharma, telecom and so on, correct. And what are our needs? Our needs are IT, pharma and, you know, but they also include drinking water, you know, solid waste management in towns for example and so on. So the obvious question is that why are these needs like drinking water or societal needs not seeing any response? Why are there no companies, right? So then we should see how companies start. So how do companies start? Well, you see the way companies usually start by entrepreneurs, okay. So what do entrepreneurs do? They actually, the creative and the societal skills are formed by the entrepreneur. So you see that box which I have drawn? That box is the entrepreneur, right. So entrepreneur does all the societal modeling, all the analysis and the synthesis, and he has a few employees like civil engineer, he may have one or two civil engineers, he may have one or two IT expert, one accounting head and so on, and that is how a company starts, correct. So you see that how you know the engineering company and entrepreneur role, you know, how they fit with each other. So you see that the entrepreneur actually gives you, you know, the has a very low cost of entry. He does not have to, you know, run big departments, does not have to run a PR campaign, no ad, nothing, right. So it just needs one or two good customers and the entrepreneur is in business, right. So then the obvious question is that why are not our problems, development problems, say water, agriculture, public health, energy, you know, why are they not being addressed, right. So they pose unique opportunities for our entrepreneurs, right, correct. But for our entrepreneurs to take them up, it must be clear that our engineering colleges must train them in this respect, must train them how to analyze problems, how to, you know, deploy solutions and how to synthesize, you know, use different areas of knowledge and come up with solutions. So unless our engineering colleges trains them to take up these skills, you know, our engineers are not going to become good entrepreneurs. That seems to me clear. So at this point, you know, I have written an article which has come in this June in Current Science. You can read it. It talks about engineering in society. You know, so three or four core conclusions from there is that there is a huge development deficit. We know that. I mean, you go out of your town or city or your home and you see that there are, you know, we are in a mess. No, our country is in a mess, right? We have, you know, our agriculture is a mess, our manufacturing is a mess, services. So we have huge development problems, right? And that's number one. Point number two, which is in blue, is that the current set of, if there's a problem, then there must be, you know, so you see, for example, that, you know, the if there's a problem, then we would expect that some companies would rush in to solve it. Well, the current companies don't seem to be solving them, right? They don't seem to be addressing what is going on, correct. So also that's number one. Number two is that we know that all of you teachers know that there are about 4 to 5 lakh engineering students joining colleges every year. Are they finding jobs with companies? No. Typical placement scenario is about 60-70% in most in the average, and maybe even less. So where are these 4 or 5 lakh? There, you know, they are aspiring for jobs in companies, in IT, pharma, they are not finding jobs, right? So that is number 2. Point number 3 is that our training in engineering colleges is actually very disciplinary. It does not train our engineers to become interdisciplinary or entrepreneurs, right? So we are not teaching our engineering students enough societal skills to pick up problems and start solving them. We are not teaching them how to interact with the district collector or Zilla Parishad or Gram Panchayat or you know, urban if you are in the chief engineer or executive engineer or you know, NGOs or workers or whatever. We are not teaching them these skills, right? So you see that there is now a supply and demand mismatch, correct? In both the corporate companies need few engineer employees, but we are producing so many. Development needs a lot of engineer entrepreneurs, but we are not teaching them. Okay, so there is a supply and demand mismatch both in the company corporate sector and in the development sector. Okay, so here is a possible solution, right? You would wonder how to come out of this trap. So I think that we have to attempt both problems at the same time, right? So what are the two? So we have to, first of all, you know, so this supply demand mismatch, we have to redirect our engineers towards development problems. We have to say that, well, look at the development, there are opportunities here, and we must train them to actually take up these problems. So for that, our universities and, you know, your parent institutions must participate in regional development. You know, your most likely your, you know, your trustees or your board has connections with regional, you know, authorities. So you must tell them that we will become the local or regional problem, you know, or solution provider. We will be the local regional knowledge, you know, knowledge base, right? So what it means is that first of all, our institutions have to step in into regional development and say that, well, we are here, we are, our students are, you know, wanting projects. Now let us start, you know, looking, doing projects together, right? Talk to the collector, talk to the CEO of your or, you know, or your city and so on, and start looking for problems, right? And then of course we must modify our curriculum so that students can actually take such things up within their curriculum and get credit, right? So remember that all developed countries, the university has played a very, very important role. So unless the university steps up to the job, we are not going to develop, right? So you see that, but note that development is not easy. Okay, most developed countries have done a lot of thinking and have decided what should the role of universities be, what should the role of companies be, what should the role of government be, and so on, correct? So I am going to present to you a small case of drinking water, how to, you know, develop this skill for the university to interact with society. Okay, so I am going to just, you know, take a small case study, right, and then then we will see how to what are the outcomes. So what are the two, three things? How do we identify a problem and break it up, correct? That's number one. You know, how do we get the data, right? And who are our stakeholders, right? After all, who do I report to? How do I judge whether my solution is successful or good, right? So we need an external metric, and we are working with external sources of data and external problems and an external stakeholder, right? And so you will say, but so, you know, as teachers, you know that unless there is an incentive for students, right, they are not going to do it. So if, you know, so the big question is that are there sufficient incentives for students and faculty members? That is one key question. So my claim is that there are. So even if your students want a job in Infosys, the skills of interacting with society are very useful. They are very useful. So these skills, even in Infosys, you know, if you join in, you know, these skills that you learn of, you know, working with stakeholders and delivery, you know, are very important. That is point number one. Point number two is that the sectors which I am talking about, water, energy, and so on, are the future. correct? They are the future. So if you learn them, then it is going to benefit students in the long run. And for faculty members, I think the government of India has, you know, so many times said that, you know, we should work, R&D should work for society. So I argue that the incentives are the right way, and there are incentives for doing such a thing. So now I am just going to switch to, you know, how to pick a problem and how to solve it. So let's look at rural drinking water. If you pick up the paper nowadays before the monsoon, that every day there is some drinking water problem. That this happened, there is no problem, this has run dry, dam has so much, and so on. So let me start with the, much of rural India actually depends on wells, right? Bore wells, hand pumps, and dug wells. That is how, so let's first, the first norm is that the government of India calls a village safe if in that village every person has access to 40 liters of water, good clean water, safe water per day. So it's called 40 LPCD, that is the norm. If every person in the village gets 40 LPCD, then the village is called safe, okay. So that's for a village. By the way, for cities the norm is 150, okay, there itself, that's the first question. Why is the city norm 150 and rural norm 40? In fact, you know, people in villages have goats and buffaloes and so on. And we don't have, in city do we have buffaloes? No. So in fact, the rural norm should have been higher. But let us now, let it be. We can work with that. So we of course know that, you know, in the summer these wells become dry, right? So you've seen this. There's a picture of a dry well. Of course, every dry well looks similar. You know, if you look at the bottom, there is nothing in the bottom, right? They all look the same. So when that happens, what happens? Well, women and girls have to go spend a long, travel long distances to fetch water, and that is a substantial amount of time and substantial amount of energy, right? And in fact, there's a study, you go, you can do it yourself, that about 1/3 to 1/4 of the energy and time of women actually go in fetching water. Guess what is the next big activity, or even bigger than this? Can you guess? Well, the answer is fetching firewood. Okay, so cooking energy and drinking water are the two biggest needs that our country suffers, right? And what are, there are 5 lakh engineers joining engineering college every year, and all of them want IT and pharma jobs. Now there seems to be a big disparity. Anyway, so let us look at, so you know, if for example the village goes dry, then many state governments initiate, I think they start supplying water through tankers. But when water supply to tankers, the consumption of water availability actually goes down to 10 or 15 LPCD, just 10 liters of water per person per day, as bad as that. So this is of course a very adverse impact on the well-being of the women and, you know, and the girls, but of course on the children. If the mom is away, mother is away for, you know, half the day fetching water, 10 liters of water, then what can the child expect? Can it expect to learn a lot? Is the food going to be good? No. So besides the women and children, you know, the whole family and the livelihood. For example, you know, once tests start, half the women work as laborers, so they are not going to earn that money. So everything really dramatically changes. So I think that cooking energy and drinking water are two major problems and opportunities. I will call them opportunities for our engineers. So here is some analysis that I did, okay, that our team in IIT Bombay we are doing. So in Thane district, we analyzed what is the, you know, drinking water situation. Okay, so let me just quickly summarize how does. So basically, it has 15 talukas, out of which 5 are tribal. Okay, and there are habitations or wadis. There are 8,000 habitations and 900 gram panchayats. By the way, do our engineering students know what a gram panchayat means? Or what sort of animal is it? Are we telling them? No. Well, anyway, let it be. So we will begin to teach them. So then you look at, if you count the staff and so on, there is 1 rural drinking water engineer, or, you know, maybe 2 for every 20,000 people. Is that going to work? No. So there is actually a great need for the development need. There is, if somehow governments can be convinced that, you know, our engineers can deliver value, then government may hire you, right? But you have to show that you can deliver, you can improve the situation. So here is, So we analyze. So you see this, this is the map of Thane, right? And these red spots are the places, are the villages which are tanker fed, in which there is severe drinking water stress. Okay. So the four talukas are Jawhar, Mukhada, Murbad and Shahpur, and largely these are tribal. So these are the talukas where there are tribals, right? So no surprise there either. So what we did was we plotted for Jawhar, Mukhada, Murbad and Shahpur the amount, the fraction of scheduled tribe, the tribal people. So you see that Jawhar has 97% tribal, Mukhada 91%, Murbad 24 and Shahpur 35, correct. But if in the tanker fed villages you can find out what are the fraction of tribals, you see, well, 97 93, so Jawhar, Mukhada, fine. But in Murbad you see that the fraction of tribal people in the tanker fed 74% and Shahpur 62%. So what does it mean? It means that tribal villages have a greater chance of facing water scarcity, correct. So you see, for here now we have, you know, we have divided the problem. We started with drinking water, which we thought was a technical problem, and then we see that, well, there may be a social problem as well, correct. So when I showed it to the collector, he started asking the engineer, what is this, what is the meaning, what is going on, right. So then anyway, but we looked at it further. So if you look at the mean elevation of these villages, then in Murbad and Shahpur, well, in Shahpur you see this blue number 197. So the tanker fed villages are roughly 60 meters higher than the non-tanker fed, than the average, right. Well, in Murbad they are the same. So in Shahpur it is likely to be a technical problem, while in Murbad it is likely to be a social problem, right. Why? Because villages, you know, tribal villages and non-tribal are at the same height, but tribal villages are not getting water. Well, in Murbad tribal villages are much higher, in Shahpur, correct. So this sort of, so you, we see that just one snapshot has actually, you know, just the spatial, you know, if you look at the spatial, by the way, in this is where the Western Ghats are, right. So these are, this is the hilly part, correct. Next. So then we looked at, you know, where are the rural regional schemes, where are the, you know, drinking water schemes, and where do you see? Well, the schemes are all over on the western side of the district. So eastern side is where the needs, the intense need is, well, and the schemes are on the all on the west. So you see that there has not been much investment on the eastern side, and maybe because of that there is drinking water stress, correct. Right. So if you show this to the planner, then they understand, yeah, and now I see what you are saying. So maybe we need to invest more in that area, correct. Well, so on this other side I have just plotted the rivers and the reservoirs, okay, rivers and reservoirs. So this is, again, you know, all of this data is available. So what I expect is that our engineering colleges should teach our students to analyze such data or regional data. They will themselves start asking the right questions. So the obvious question is that why can't we have more rural regional drinking water schemes, right? The obvious is we should have them more. So then you see that there are many issues. There are technical issues, right? There are economic issues, and there are social and governance issues, right? What are the economic, that should pay, the technical issues are clear. I mean, all engineers know that you have to, well, design, build tanks, simulate the stuff, then optimize, and so on and so forth. So economic issues are that capital and running costs, benefits, then who's to, then by the way, what are the social and governance issues? Well, who's to pay, right? Ownership, is the Zilla Parishad going to run the scheme? Who's going to own it? Is it a private public partnership? Who's going to collect the bills? What if, no, somebody doesn't pay, right? So there are many social and governance issues as well. So there are technical, economic, and so I think that our engineers should be taught to understand all of these issues, okay. So here is what we did. So we started with Karjat Taluka in another district, which is actually just south of Thane, and we, you know, on our own, we said that is a scheme like this feasible or not, okay. By the way, Raigad district is just south and has a similar problem. So let's pick these, you know, these wadis and villages which have a severe drinking water stress, and let us see a techno-economic feasibility of whether a rural regional drinking water scheme is possible. Okay. So, by the way, we did this. So, you know, if I am going to produce a feasibility study, then it had better be acceptable to the government. So, in my feasibility study, I used exact government norms, their way of designing stuff, their costing methods, right. So, I want my feasibility study to be accessible and acceptable to the government or to the district administration. So, I use exactly PWD norms and procedures, right, everything, and I made sure that my reporting is back to the PWD, local MLA and other people. Okay. By the way, this study was done by 3 students over 6 months, that is all. Okay. So, let us see what does the scheme have. So, essentially if a large scheme will have a source, then a jackwell and a pump, then a water treatment plant, then a mass balancing reservoir, and then clusters of villages each fed by individual tanks, right. So, there is a cluster here, there is a cluster here, there is a cluster here and so on, correct. Is that clear? So, this is what a scheme looks like. It has a source, then a pump and a treatment plant, and by the way, from this MBR or mass balancing reservoir, everything is gravity fed. Okay. So, the energy costs are in taking the water from here, from the jackwell source to the MBR. After that, it is all gravity. Is that clear? So, this is how a drinking water scheme looks like. So, essentially, you know, here are the basic steps. First of all, you have to assess the need, right, where all, which are the villages which need water, how severe is it, right, and what is the extent. So, it is, so you have to meet with all stakeholders, you have to meet with the, you know, taluka administration, you meet the gram panchayat, the sarpanches, you know, NGOs who are reporting these problems. So, you meet all of them, right, and assess what the demand is. Then you have to do the, you know, locate a source. So, you have to locate maybe there is a lake or a reservoir, but you know, you do, if you want to take water from it, maybe there is other competitive uses. So, you do, you know, you have to take clearances and so on. Then you have to go through the population data and plot the demand. What is going to be the demand 2012, 14, 15, 20, 30 year, you know, horizon. So, you have to extend what the current and the past population was and produce the future, you know, scenario. So, after this first step and the second step, now the technical problem specification is ready. So, this was the modeling part, right. This part was the modeling part, right. Correct. Now, let us look at the technical part. You know, you have to cluster the villages, then pipe diameter, head calculate and compute cost and so on. So, this is typically what we teach in our engineering college. Do we teach this, the first part? No, but this is equally important. Okay. Now, after that, the final thing is to take it back to the people, to, you know, to the PWD, to the Tehsildar, to the BDO, to the Gram Panchayat and so on. Correct. So, here are some pictures. So, you know, by the actually visiting villages, you know, ascertaining what the demand is, doing technical design, meeting with NGOs, meeting with the you know, the taluka officers. So, by the way, here is the sarpanch, one of the sarpanches. Here is the you know, assistant engineer of the tehsil. Here is me, and here are some students. Okay. So, this is another student. These are students and faculty members. These are actual, this by the way, this was Saraiwadi, which is a tribal village. So, you see that you have to do all of these things, and then, you know, the students actually end up learning a lot more next. So, by the way, this is, you know, it is about 120 square kilometer area. This is the extent, and just to give you what the area looks like next, and this is the source. This is the source of the that we picked up. So, it is actually the discharge from a hydel power station. So, it is perennial, right. So, selecting a source for a rural drinking water scheme must be robust. It cannot be seasonal, correct? Otherwise, the scheme is bound to fail. So this is our source. Next, so these are the habitations. Okay, these are, so we are, by the way, you are using Google Earth, right? So these are the, have pinpointed every location, every habitation. So by the way, you know what, in my area, maybe not in your area, right? In my area, each habitation is roughly 200-300 people, and you know, mainly it is close to their farms. In Konkan belt, how do people stay? Well, people stay close to their farms, right. So, all the habitations, you know, in a gram panchayat, there may be 10, 12, 15 habitations, correct. So, I have located all the habitations here. So what do I do? Latitude, longitude, elevation, population, and growth rate. Right? Once all of these are done, I know what the demand is. Next. Then here is my network. So I, you know, those 70 odd habitations, each red dot is a cluster. So there is going to be a tank for that cluster. Right? Once I have a tank for each cluster, right, then I have to, you know, and this is the, you know, at this spot is where the main balancing MBR is. So from this is the source, water is going to flow up from here to here, and then by gravity it is going to go everywhere else. Okay. So we have to minimize the cost and, you know, of this network and do the engineering design. So it includes next. So here is a close up, you know, for example, note that there are many things to be taken care of here. For example, we have seen that if you want to implement it, then the pipeline must go along roads, because otherwise nobody is going to give you their land, correct? So these are things which you must, you know, you talk to PWD and understand how are things designed, and use exactly their norms. So for example, here we are showing where are the bends in the pipe that has to be accounted for and simulated, correct? Next. So here is the close up, here is the river, and here is the water treatment plant and the MBR. So by the way, all of this is actually a play on elevations and gravity field, and so we essentially used a couple of simulators and a design tool, and we ourselves did a bit of a patching and so on. Next. So finally, after all of this, right, so what was the output? Well, this was the final economic output, that if you want to supply 200 LPCD, then the per capita investment would be roughly 7,000, and at 40 LPCD, the per capita investment would be roughly 2,200. This was in 2010, correct? So by the way, the government of Maharashtra norm is 2,300, that if a scheme falls within 2,300 per capita, then it gets automatic approval. So what have we shown? We have shown essentially that the net investment for pipe water at 40 and 200 is economically feasible, right? So by the way, for cities with the 200 LPCD norm, the norm is roughly, you know, 10,000. For example, Thane city or Mumbai city, the investment per person is in of the order of 10,000. Okay, so once you, by the way, we also computed the energy cost, which is roughly five rupees per cubic meter. Fine. So you see, if you do such a few, by the way, on our Moodle, the full report and the full presentation which we made to the district collector is available on our web page on Moodle, right? So you see, this report actually changes reality. Why? Because now the people will say, well, IIT has done this report, it shows that it is feasible. Why are you guys not doing it, right? So that create this knowledge which a local or a regional institute has created has now taken the step forward, one step forward to easing the difficulties of the people, right? It has, you know, a regional institute has now taken up, you know, has tried to improve the living standards of the neighboring area, right? And do you see engineering opportunities here? Sure. You know, if this scheme is to be taken up, it's going to need engineers, it's going to need applied social scientists, it's going to need demographers, it's going to need so many people, and it's going to create value. Correct? Next. So what are the outcomes? Well, for Karzat, you know, Karzat taluka, well, it says, well, development is it brings about development. Correct? And so by the way, the report was presented to the local MLA and to the six sarpanches, to the six gram panchayats, and the report was adopted unanimously by the six gram panchayats. Right? So now you got to understand how governance works. The way it works is that if there's a proposal, you know, we have a democracy, right? So gram panchayat have to adopt it officially, right? Adopt it in the gram sabha, and then take the demand to the tehsil office. Then the tehsil office aggregates the demand and gives it to the district design or district engineers, and then they have to sit and design it. So now what has happened? The demand has gone from these six gram panchayats, because they now know ki there may be a solution. So they have now taken the demand to the district engineers, and now the state engineers have to either refute what we have said or do the design, detailed design. Is that clear? So all of this has, all of this is actually happening. So now if you look at for us, for the institute, right? So what have I been saying, that you people should also take up such a role. So now this part is, how does it benefit the institute? So if, first of all, there's a lot of R&D content in it. Okay, we novel use of GIS, Google Earth, new optimization problems, all of them are publishable in international journals. All of this result is actually publishable in international journals. Okay, so, and of course we discovered new uses of, we design simulation packages, adapting simulation packages to our needs and so on. So the first two are really, novel and, actually publishable R&D. The last part is really important, recognition for the institute, that we are now known in Karzat as, oh, that IIT, well, let's, if there's a new problem, let's go to IIT, let's, maybe they have something to say, right? So I'm sure that your engineering college, if it, gets such a name in your taluka or district, it is going to be very important, and I'm sure your board of governors or your institute is going to like it, or your collector or whatever is going to like it. So I think that, this is really, this is a win-win situation. You get, engineers get employed or understand these skills, it brings our development, right? So this is exactly what we wanted, that we want our local universities to be local problem solvers. Is that clear? So you would say, now where do I, okay, now this is really nice, what do I do now? Okay, so first of all, you don't have to look at drinking water, of course, very important, but there are many other sectors like the energy, public transport, water, public health, and so on. Town planning, if you are town, all sorts of needs are coming up. Just 5 days ago, there was a fire in a big Bombay building, right, in the Mantralaya. Now, just doing an analysis of a building about evacuation times and so on is going to, is going to save lives and save costs. So there are plenty of opportunities. So there are, what perhaps you should do is, you go to www.sitara.itb, that which I have linked, and study this TDSL program there, or go to my web page and look at all that stuff. Okay. So set aside some funding, have 2 or 3 coordinating faculty members per institute. Okay, they are going to interact. So identify 2 or 3 faculty members who are good at interacting with people outside, who have actually worked in the private sector or worked with government agencies and so on. So form a cell, set aside some funding, modify the curriculum to allow BTech students or engineering students to take up such projects, right? And have your institution have a broad meeting with the collector, with the board, your principal, and have a meeting and say that we are here, okay? And Sitara can help. Okay, so if indeed you are interested, then what are the various models that this interaction can bring about? What are the, and by the way, Sitara also has this MTech program in technology and development. So we actually train our, in the master's program, we train our students to take up exactly such a role. Right, so we may, you may want to hire one of our MTech students, graduates, as a coordinator, regional coordinator, where he or she, we have trained him or her to take up such problems, formulate them, and give it to solution, put it up for solution. Right, so you may want to contact us. By the way, you should also look at the Sitara MTech program for how it is designed. It has many parts, and I think it would be interesting for you also at the graduate level. So at the undergraduate level, the TDSL program is perhaps the right thing. At the graduate level is the MTech program, technology and development. Okay. So really, I have just explained that what our vision is. The development vision is that engineering colleges must be regional solution providers. And so eventually, I think that local, eventually DST will discover that if you are producing, DST will rush, I hope that if you are doing quality work at the regional level, I am sure that DST funding will follow. Of course, you have to make a nice proposal and so on. But getting the collector to say that, well, we want these problems solved and they are doing a good job, I am sure that there is funding, state level funding or DST or DIIT or whatever, you will get the funding, fine. So I think that, research funding, instead of being concentrated at places like IITs, should actually go down to regional institutes, right. And that will happen only when you start, saying that we are the regional solution providers. Okay, so I hope that this was useful. Thank you very much. So, if you have any questions,
That study that you did in 2010,
yeah,
we want to know how much did it cost, and whether it has been implemented till now or not, because it's been almost 2 years since then.
Right. So, actually, that's a good question. Yeah, that's a good question. So, first of all the reports are there in all the reports are there on Moodle or also on my web page. And the study was done in 2010, which is about 2 years ago, and the report was presented only in September, October, so end of 2010. So, by the way, now there are several other issues which are connected. This rural drinking water scheme is going to be really big. So, who is going to invest? So, I don't think it remains a technical problem now. So, it now is a policy problem. So, is there going to be a private partnership and so on, correct? So, don't think that the technical problem is the only thing, but the technical feasibility now opens up avenues. So, now we are going to see the government, it has to go to the ministry and say, oh well, we want public private partnership to solve this problem. So, we have to come now, only after the technical thing is solved will it go to the implement the funding and the institutional phase and the policy phase. So, it is in the Mantralaya. It's like it's working out. Does that satisfy you? But the reports are all there on our web page or on Moodle.
No, I'm more concerned about implementation of whatever study that you did, because if somebody from IIT Bombay does a study, it carries a lot of weight.
Correct.
But say a private college like ours does this study, it will have a lot less weight. So probably the implementation for our project will be
you're right. I think I understand what you're saying, that IIT, I understand what you're saying, but Sitara can help. I mean, we can technically vet it, we can develop partnership, you can borrow IIT's name or whatever, but it has to, first of all, it has to be technically sound, correct? And that is, and the other thing is that once it is technically sound, it can go to the collector will send it for by the way, you have to compete with the local implementing agency. That's one thing, and that the collector or the local administration is going to appreciate that there is a second opinion. Yeah.
Periyar Manimai, Tanjavur.
Thank you for your inspirational, thought-provoking lecture, sir. So we have a Periyar Pura scheme. So we adopted 65 villages in around Periyar Manimai University. We have a Periyar community radio for giving social programs to enrich their societal problems. So, can we have a rural education through our Periyar community radio? Is there any possible way to import rural education through our Periyar community radio or Akash tablet? Can you have a
there are many
any
options.
Funding for
yeah,
that?
Thank, funding. Well, I am not. I myself am seeking funding all the time. No, but not really. But what I'm saying is that, well, that's very nice to hear what all you have done. I think that perhaps if you can document and send me some reports of what you have done, maybe then I can reply to it more carefully. So what I would like, first of all, there are two things. You should probably send me some reports. And secondly, have you integrated the curriculum structure and R&D structure to what you are doing in society? Okay, so I think that don't regard development as a emotional question, but as a professional question. Okay, that it is not about doing good or doing things out of the heart, but it is good engineering actually means development. Okay, so it is more about the way engineering is taught and not about doing good. I hope you understand what I'm saying. So please do send me a report.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Sir, good afternoon, and let me congratulate you and your team and IIT. Actually, sir, I am from Sinhagad Institute, Lonavala. Lonavala itself is a remote place. Actually, we have taken this kind of initiative. We wanted to educate some of the illiterate student which are located nearby Lonavala. We have taken one project, but unfortunately we could not complete that project. The second project which now you are listed in, and we are very much interested to work with, is the energy sector. Actually, the situation of Maharashtra, in the rural places, most of the villages don't get the electricity for 24 hours. So that's the good project, and where we can think about the renewable energy sources to be implemented in the Maharashtra. And in this kind of project, actually, if we are to implement, we need a lot of funding for doing research, for doing survey, and getting it implemented. And if we want to have this kind of project to be implemented, can we get some help and the guidelines from the IT side? That is my one question. Mm-hmm. And the second one is that, as you have started your own MTech courses, it is possible at IITN, since it's an autonomous institute, but since we are affiliated to certain universities, sometimes it becomes difficult for us to have these kind of courses in our curriculum. So can we have some corresponding kind of courses from IIT where our students can interact with the IIT people, and they get actually idea of how this kind of project or how this work can be done at the rural places? Over to you, sir.
Thank you. So first of all, you see that I keep saying it to everyone, that development is an intellectual question. It is not an emotional question. That you are helping illiterate students, all that is good, but that is not engineering. That is number one. An engineering college must do everything which is technically sound. Okay, if it involves talking to illiterate people, good, but you cannot say that something I am doing good from the heart is does not make, will not give you funding, or give, will not satisfy your engineers. So it has to be, first of all, a very sound technical and social, it has to be scientific. That is number one. So you know that you are working with NGO helping illiterate people and all that is okay, but that is not the way to go. You have to put it in a more robust and sound footing. That is number one. Number two, a lot of our studies need very minimal funding. We just need travel to and fro and daily TADA. I am sure your institute will have that funding. All the other tools that we use are free. Okay, so first you start doing things, funding will follow. Is that okay?
Sir, my second question was, as like IIT are having their own curriculum about the MTech course,
actually,
can we have, actually we are located at certain places and we are affiliated to
the university. I understand. So actually, we have collaborated with a college in Karjat, college in Sangli and so on. So they are managing it to do it through their BTech project, that BTech project, in their BTech project they are doing such work. So there are always ways out of doing this, and if you want to approach the university, we will help you.
It is Indur Goyal.
First of all, I wish to congratulate you for making this excellent presentation and showing as to how engineering can be viewed as a socially responsible activity. Okay, I wish to know what are the other activities that Sitara is doing of this prototype. I understand there was one on making efficient bullock carts and bicycle, those types of things.
So please visit the web page.
Okay, the second question is, according to you, how much is the rural need for water per day per person?
200. 300. 300 LPCD.
Thank you very much.
Saint Margaret Engineering College.
Sir, how we can utilize the research in computer science for the enhancement of agriculture productivity in rural area?
I think, I can answer this in many ways, but this is not about applying something to something. We are talking about a methodology of research. So if you have questions on that, I will answer. Otherwise, send me an email, I will answer that question. So stick to the point.
Banari Aman Institute of Technology, Erode.
How to assess the Center of Technology project, sir?
Why don't you visit the web page? Why don't you visit our web page? If you see the presentation, it has two web pages on the first slide. So visit those web pages.
Jaipur College, Kukas.
Best harvesting system in Rajasthan, basically it's a rural area, and I want to implement this project, but the main key problem in this is that there is no funding available as in required right now, and I don't know how to apply the funding for some institute like MHRD, AICT and others. So sir, is there any way to make a proposal?
So I will repeat the question. they said, how can I use sensor network in agriculture or some such area, and how do I make a proposal? Well, I think that I will answer the first thing that my point of my talk was, that don't start with sensor network, start with the problem, and if the problem needs sensor network, then it will get funded. You understand what I was saying is that we are, our engineering is teaching people to start with sensor network and look for a problem. That is not the way to go. Start with the problem and see what skills you need. I hope that is clear.
Ram Babu, Islampur. Go ahead.
Hello. I am Sushma Kulkarni, Director of Rajaram Babu Institute of Technology. I don't have any question because we are already associated with Sitara. One of the professors had inquired that how it can be included in curriculum and how we can do it. But we are actually already doing it. We have started this semester now, and Sitara, especially Dr. Sohni, is supporting us completely, and value-added trainings and everything is supported and provided. And I am very sure that large number of institutes can take up such projects, a network with the social NGOs and Jilla Parishad collectors and all those things, and you can go ahead, and students also enjoy it. The feedback which I am getting from my students and faculty is that they are enjoying doing this project. So this was just a feedback which I wanted to give to Professor Sohni and all the professors who wish to take up this project. Thank you.
PhD Coimbatore, word.
Sir, we have a question on your case study. Sir, you have presented a good case study on drinking water, and some of the data you have been you could be added to make a better case study. That you have started or began with water scarcity and concluded with economic water distribution.
Correct.
A past data on average rainfall, groundwater level, and delay in monsoon may also be taken into account. And you have not mentioned that what are the various schemes which has been implemented to improve the level of groundwater level, sir.
So good questions. Actually, yeah, thank you very much. So actually, if you visit my web page, and there is a link to water research on my web page, there you will see the extent of study that we are doing. We look at groundwater, we look at surface water, we look at reservoirs, water supply schemes, groundwater testing, modeling, observation wells, everything. So this case study could not illustrate all aspects, but that research is ongoing. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Really, we appreciate your effort taken in this direction. Thank you once again.